welcome to my presentation. Thanks everybody for joining me today. My name is Rob Lee, and today we're gonna be talking about ICS cyber attacks, fact versus fiction. There's been a lot of discussion lately on ICS or industrial control systems, the type of systems that operate things like the power grid and water filtration and oil and gas pipelines. And we have seen a rise in intrusions that's given a lot of people a good bit of alarm. So we want to make sure that we have a good presentation on exactly what we can and what we shouldn't be concerned with, and really a little bit of the nuance that sometimes gets lost. So for those of you that don't know me, my name is Rob Lee. I run a firm called Dragos. It's an industrial security firm. And I'm also a course author and instructor of the SANS Institute, where I author the community's ICS incident response and threat hunting course, as well as the threat intelligence course for the larger, broader InfoSec community. My previous life, I spent time in the U.S. government, and while over in one of the intelligence agencies, I built their first mission looking at nation states breaking into industrial security sites, or excuse me, industrial sites. So a career looking at these threats. For a portion of my career, I was also on the offense as well for the government. So I try to bring a little bit of perspective on what it's like to be an offensive person as well as that defender and intelligence analyst. Because I often find that folks on one side of the fence tend to think everybody else's job is easier, right? Like, oh, defenders have it so easy. Or likewise, oh, the offense has the upper hand. It's so easy to be offense, and to do attacks is trivial. And that's just not the case. And there's quite a bit of nuance there that needs to be captured so we can understand and prepare correctly. So my agenda today is pretty simple. Over this next 30 minutes, really just gonna first dive into the fiction, some of the hype around reporting. I often joke around that there's no good news story about the power grid. We don't get like a New York Times article that says like, hey, power is still on, congratulations. Like, it's not very common. Sometimes we hear some good reporting, like after major events like Hurricane Harvey and Irma. It was newsworthy just how fast those operators and grid workers got back and got the power back in those regions. So that was cool. But oftentimes it's the headlines like, oh my gosh, we're all gonna die, power grid failures, build a bunker. And that's not really reasonable. And then we'll jump into ICS facts. I'll actually walk you through sort of how attacks exist and work. And we'll end it on a case study with what happened in the Ukraine. So I also write little comics. I found in my time in the military and in the government that being able to condense things down to three panes of comics were pretty effective at communicating technical topics to generals and congressmen and the like. And also it was just fun for everybody. So I still do that over at Little Bobby Comic every Sunday. But here we have the CISO waxing poetically that they need to ensure that there are no attacks that occur. And Little Bobby asks for a security budget. The CISO tells him, well, we cut it all out. And Little Bobby rightfully says, well, then I can assure you we'll never see any attacks. And that's also what kind of leads to this hype and reporting, where there's not a lot of information that gets shared around real attacks and real cases and real incidents. And it's pretty common that this subject matter is important to everybody. A lot of people are interested in the power grid, oil refineries, manufacturing sites. You know, it's an interesting topic to a lot of folks. And what ultimately happens is, as there is not a lot of information shared, people worry and fear the worst. It's very, very common in DC, actually, where I'm based out of Maryland. I routinely run across, you know, congressional staffers and folks, many who are trying to do awesome work, but sometimes they have the idea that because we don't get visibility into the threats that are targeting industrial, that it must be worse than we fear, worse than we can imagine. And that's not necessarily the case. I often tell people that the threats are worse than we realize, but they're not as bad as we can imagine. And there are things that go on, but of course, in the lack of that information, that's where the hype forms. People wanting to tell a story, but of course, it not being backed by facts. So let's walk through a couple of these. One of the early ones in the community that happened, I mean, these have been around forever, hyped out stories, but one of the early ones is in Illinois. There was a water utility, Kerner Gardner, and it had a pump failure. And under the state regulations, they needed to report up the pump failure. And the fusion center for the state got the report that there was a pump failure at this site. But see, 2011 was just the year after most people learned that SCADA was a thing, right? So in 2010, when Stuxnet occurred and everyone was like, oh my gosh, ICS and SCADA, it's everywhere. And then people started dawning on them that, yeah, industrial systems are everywhere. There was a lot of concern that there was going to be some sort of cyber attack back on the United States. And apparently that would be a pump failure in a water utility, which I joked at the time that if, you know, the Russians or the Iranians or anybody was going to target the U.S., and if their big effect was having a pump failing at a small water utility, then I think we're okay. But at the time, the State Fusion Center folks got involved. It ended up getting looked at, and they didn't properly talk to the engineers or the folks on the ground. And they ended up getting access to the logs and saw that there was a Russian IP address in the logs 5 months before the pump failure. So they made a correlation issue, a causation correlation kind of error, and said, aha, because there was a Russian IP in the logs, we know that the Russians were remoting in, and therefore they caused the pump failure. First of all, of course, we don't do attribution based off of IP address lookups. But second of all, just because something occurred on the network doesn't necessarily mean that it was related to the outage or the failure. And in fact, after this would get leaked and it got leaked out to the news media, and the news media ran with the story, Russian cyber attack on water utility. The contractor who actually did the remoting in read it in the papers and said, well, hold on, no, that was me. And what it was a contractor was on vacation in St. Petersburg and remoted into the utility. And that's why the Russian IP showed up. And the pump only failed because there was just a buildup of residue. And that buildup caused a failure that was actually pretty typical and pretty normal to occur. Yet a lot of people got hyped up pretty quickly about this. There's another big one as well, the North Iran cyber attacks. I remember this when it first came out. I was still in the government at the time. I didn't leave the intelligence community and the military until 2015. But in the beginning portions of 2015, before I transitioned out, I remember getting a call 3 o'clock in the morning. Is Iran coming? And then like 3 o'clock in the morning, right? Waking up like, what? Like, is Iran coming? I'm like, I'm pretty sure they're going nowhere, but I can get into an office because this line is not secure. I can find a classified line, but who is this? Oh, this is so-and-so in the National Security Council. And I don't need to tell you much about military ranks in the government to let you know that Captain Lee was pretty far under where the National Security Council could have been contacting. But I guess they read my name on some of the ICS reporting that was being done in the government, and somebody freaked out, wanted to get some ground truth on what was happening. I let them know, hey, you know, it's going to take me a while to get into a classified area. And they're like, no, it's an unclassified report. I'm like, okay, send it on over. And what I get was a teal pea green, which ultimately would get violated. So it's okay to talk about it here. But this teal pea green document from a vendor called Norse that said, Iran is preparing for a cyber offensive. They are getting ready to attack a bunch of industrial control systems in the United States. And they actually said that they had already attacked 500,000 times, which should give you some level of understanding that the metrics just don't match reality. And as you read through the report, it was pretty obvious that what they were talking about is they stood up honeypots on the internet, sometimes not even honeypots, but just IP ranges. And for every single scan from an Iranian IP address, they registered it as one. And if it had anything to do with like port 502 or port 102 or any of these TCP ports that had anything to do with ICS, they registered that as an ICS cyber attack. Completely inappropriate, not at all good reporting. And we were able to push back on that pretty quickly in the government channels. But unfortunately, they then took it and partnered with the conservative think tank AEI and tried to re-release it in April 2015 at RSA. And this time they said, look, based on the Norse cyber attack data, the nuclear negotiations with Iran should fail because we have proof that if you relieve Iranian sanctions, they will use this the relief to target industrial control systems and critical infrastructure. And I thought this was highly inappropriate. I don't really care anybody's politics about the Iranian situation, but I would hope that we can all agree that political decisions, especially between states, should probably be built off of real data, maybe even real threat intelligence, not the honeypot scans of non-ICS. So that was a good example of our community getting thrown into politics in an inappropriate way. And then, of course, we had another one, 2008 Turkey pipeline explosion. So in 2008, a pipeline called the BTC pipeline in Turkey did actually explode, large fireball. Luckily, everyone that I'm familiar with, at least I'm familiar with the case, everyone I know of was safe in that case, which is great. But years later, about 6 years later, Bloomberg ended up publishing a report saying, hey, that mysterious 08 pipeline, yeah, it was actually a Russian cyber attack. And that was at odds with what we knew to, from historical purposes, because at the time that it occurred back in 2008, the Turkish government said it was the Kurdish extremists. And the Kurdish extremists came out and said, yeah, it was us. So that was pretty good attribution at the time. So to hear that there was a new theory being waged, that it was actually a cyber attack and by Russia, that was pretty intense. So I got involved and started talking to the journalists and trying to do my own digging. And as it turns out, I don't think the journalists meant to mislead anybody. And I don't think anything was intentionally wrong on their part. I just think that it was a complex, nuanced, and technical topic. And I think they got misled by some incident responders. What ultimately happened is after the attack, some incident responders went in to the control center and they found malware beaconing out to a Russian IP address. And just like the first, you know, Kerner Gardner case that we talked about where people assigned an inappropriate causal analysis, the incident responders determined, aha, because there was an explosion and because there was malware on the control center, they must be related. And again, that's not true. And actually, there's tons of information, historical and leaked information about exactly what happened with the BTC pipeline. They even found explosives and various fractures on the pipeline caused by some physical presence of people. So it had nothing to do with the cyber attack. But that's pretty big, bold kind of claim again, and kind of creates a little bit of that tension between those states, which is really brings us to the second to last case study on hype. And in 2015, later in 2015, there was a 10-hour power failure in Turkey. And what I thought was most interesting about this one is in the first couple of hours of that outage occurring, before anyone could have possibly had any understanding of root cause analysis or what actually occurred, we saw major news sources all around the world, from Bloomberg to CNN, I mean, everywhere, saying, look, because we know that Iran is launching cyber attacks against ICS because of the Norse report, and because we know that Turkey's been targeted before because of the Bloomberg report on the BTC pipeline, we assess that the Turkey pipeline or the Turkey blackout might actually be a cyber attack by Iran. That is totally inappropriate. In the early hours of outages of any type of infrastructure going down, your state level and national level officials are pretty concerned, especially for something like the power grid. And for national level leaders to be told by major news outlets, hey, this might actually be a cyber attack, especially when it's built off of previously been debunked, hyped out stories, you can imagine that this has increased to some level of geopolitical tension at the time. In the days following the outage, because it takes a while, we would find out that the outage was a result of it being one of the hotter days on record, and it was overheating the transformers that caused a failure that cascaded across a couple sites. Completely possible, completely normal thing to occur. It's just aging infrastructure. That's why we have to make sure that we're investing in infrastructure and keeping up to date, but has nothing to do with cyber. And then the last one that I just think is kind of funny, unrelated, but a good one, nevertheless, the conference, I believe it was last year in Tel Aviv, where one of the ministers got up and said, look, Tel Aviv is where we're having this conference. And it was the minister of, I think, energy and resources in Israel, and said, look, at this very moment, I'm paraphrasing here, but he's like, at this very moment, we are experiencing one of the worst cyber attacks in history on our power grid. Well, that's pretty bold. That's from a government official. So that's decently authoritative. And so CNN and a couple of others ran the headlines. And this is actually a screen capture from one of the news articles. Israeli power grid suffers massive cyber attack, because that's what was said. But unfortunately, what the minister meant to say was, oh, it's in our regulatory authority, which has nothing to do with our power grid, just a small office with like 30 computers and some people. And oh, by the way, it's what really happened is somebody opened up a phishing email that had ransomware on it. So kind of a little bit different than power grid is suffering massive cyber attack versus in an office completely unrelated to the power grid, somebody has ransomware. So, you know, got to be a little bit nuanced sometimes. And that is, of course, the point as well. We consistently see, no matter what happens, whether San Francisco and New York both have a small power outage at the same time, or whether some train derails, the first thing people jump to is cyber attack. And that's not even the most likely scenario. That's definitely possible. We have to be concerned about threats, and we'll walk through them in the second half of the presentation. But we've got to be a little bit more nuanced than this. And a lot of the quotes that get captured sometimes in the media are, governor's office not refusing to say that it's not a cyber attack. Well, yeah, because they have no information. I mean, I'm not refusing to say that it wasn't a squirrel, but it's not, I mean, it's probably not what happened, but I don't know what it wasn't, because we don't know what it was. Anyways, so let's talk about the real things. And Alice here walking down a little Bobby saying, hey, what are you doing? He says, oh, I'm installing this next gen software to protect me against foreign governments. Well, why is there a pop-up that you need to patch your system? Oh yeah, yeah, I'll get to that later. And my point here is, a lot of the stuff that we want to do to be able to raise that bar in security and make it where we have very defensible environments, all that stuff is the simplistic stuff. I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation that I had been on the offense for a portion of my career, not pen test, not red team, but actually somebody else's APT. And I'll note that never in my day did we think to ourselves, how am I going to impress the defender when they find me? Like that's not the point. The point was, you got a bunch of missions and everybody in the world has management and PowerPoint, even your offensive people. And so it was this idea about, how do we just get on with our lives? How do we keep doing the mission? And actually, there's operational risk in being fancy. If I leverage really cool tools, really cool exploits, really cool tradecraft, you're going to call in some senior incident responders. This is going to get everybody's attention, and it's going to be defense versus offense. And it's going to be very, very hard on the offense actually at that point. But if I come in with some basic piece of malware on a vulnerability that's existed for 5 years or something, I'm not losing any tradecraft. I'm not exposing anything that I'm at risk on. And more importantly, if you see the adversary at that point, well, you might just bypass it as something not that important. So there's actually an operational benefit for adversaries being basic and only doing what they need to do the mission. So if you're constantly trying to prioritize the next gen things, but you've missed the current gen things that we're supposed to be doing, it might be something to reevaluate in your posture. So let's talk about real threats and really, again, the problem. So when it comes to the ICS community, one of our biggest problems is that there's not a lot of people in this industry. Some of the public numbers put it around to be 1,000 or so ICS cybersecurity for professionals worldwide. Simply not a lot of people. And also, we don't really know our threat landscape. The chart on the right is metrics from the ICS certs, and they're fairly authoritative body, even though a lot of the metrics are, you know, they could be dug a little bit deeper into to realize that there's a problem with a lot of the metrics. But one of the things that doesn't really get advertised out or catch any of the headlines every year is the fact that the number one attack vector every single year into industrial control systems is unknown. And the number two attack vector is spear phishing, except we don't have a lot of email servers and SCADA environments. So what the metrics are really saying is, if we see it, it's because IT catches it going into the ICS. But if it's just in the ICS, we have no idea how it got there. And a lot of times people don't have the logging or the visibility set up. So we absolutely do need to do better. And we've got to get more visibility into those environments and take a more secure posture. Because one of the things I love about our industrial infrastructure is it's very, very defensible. I actually have the position that our ICS infrastructure is more defensible than IT, especially with the weird systems that we have, the physical engineering, the complexity that it takes for an adversary to accomplish a mission that they can be confident and they're going to get the exact output that they're looking for. We have an awesome opportunity. And with the right application of security, we can do very well because we do have real threats. There are plenty of case studies on insiders causing issues across the industrial community, whether it's at random stories about rail stations or reversing the flow of sewage and Mirushi, Australia. Of course, there was the big S word, right, when the Iranian nuclear reactors were physically destroyed, centrifuges via Stuxnet. We had Dragonfly back in 2013 that compromised sites around the world, and then Dragonfly 2.0 just a little bit earlier this year, compromising industrial control system environments. I got a lot of news covers because they said, oh my gosh, they're taking off screenshots of the HMIs with a human-machine interface. We're all going to die. Like, no, we're not. We're actually going to walk through it here in a couple of minutes on how these attacks occur and the fact that it's a little bit more nuanced than that. And an attacker, even with direct access to control system environment, is not necessarily going to be able to have a reliable effect. And it's definitely not going to be some big cascading failure at that point. We also had Electrum, which was the creators of Crash Override, which we'll talk about at the end of this presentation. And then Sandworm, who's the folks that used it and also took down the Ukrainian power grid in 2015, the first cyber attack in history that resulted in outages in the power grid. We have Crisine and Magnalium. There's some groups that we track internally. They're groups that are also targeting industrial sites, both in petrochemical and in electric energy. And then, of course, you just have tons of incidental malware infections. And we've done a ton of research. There's publicly referenced there. You can go on YouTube and search for Mimics at the SANS ICS Summit. And basically, we just went out and said, look, how many incidental infections occur inside of industrial control environments every year? Let's see if we can get some metrics on this. And we compiled all the data and hunted through it and tried to deduplicate it and figure that there's around 4,000 or 5,000 infections per year inside of industrial environments. But it's things like Conficker and Slammer and old malware. And I often tell people that Conficker has done more damage to the American power grid than Iran, China, and Russia combined. But we still do need to be nuanced because Conficker is not going to plan out an attack at the right political or the worst time for us. And it's not going to be something too complicated, whereas a foreign adversary might. So there's a balance that we need to have. The highest likelihood is not necessarily the highest risk. And again, there are real attacks, but let's walk through these. If you're really going to do an ICS cyber attack, there's some things you're going to have to do. Mike Asante over at the SANS Institute and I authored a paper years ago titled The ICS Cyber Kill Chain. And in what we did is we basically said that there's two stages to an ICS cyber attack. The first stage mimics very closely the cyber kill chain that Lockheed Martin built years ago, the one that basically all the InfoSec community uses to analyze intrusions, which is this idea that an adversary is going to do some sort of planning. They're going to target an environment, you know, maybe weaponize an email by having malware inside of an attachment, send it to somebody. They're going to open it up. It's going to exploit the system, install malware, reach back to command and control addresses that the adversary owns, and then do some sort of action. And a lot of that stuff can happen really quickly, minutes or hours, or sometimes even just days in terms of compromising an entire company after the start of an adversary's campaign. And at that act phase, in a normal IT environment, it might be espionage, it might be stealing intellectual property, maybe it's even just ransomware. But in ICS environments, what we're looking for is for the adversary to find access to the operational network and also steal off data related to the industrial network, like engineering documents and information about how it's being used. And it's not just going to happen in the one company, but it would likely need to happen in a couple of companies, especially for more complex systems that depend on each other, like electric energy. But even in petrochemical and manufacturing, as an example, they would likely still need to target places like their integrators and figure out the engineering documents and how the system was built and set up. Because not everything about industrial controls is connected on the network for an IP address. A lot of it's physical engineering process, and you've got to learn that stuff before you can actually develop an attack. So once you do all that stage one stuff, which is a lot of gathering of data, usually across multiple companies, then you can interpret all that data, and it's not simple to do. You've got to interpret, are there any safety systems? Okay, well, are there relief valves? Are there, you know, what's the physical process? How does it the engineering impact the network? How does the network impact the engineering? Is there a way? You ultimately will develop knowledge on that industrial environment. And with that knowledge, you might develop a malicious capability like Crash Override, or you might just develop a way that you're going to abuse the ICS against itself. There doesn't need to be malware involved. It can just be learning to use the industrial equipment against itself. If a SCADA operator can turn on the lights and turn off the lights using the SCADA system, then so could the adversary. And there's also going to need to be some level of testing. If you're going to have some highly reliable, high confidence attack that modifies and actually does an attack, right? Modifies the process or destroys equipment or disrupts in some significant way, you're not just going to come out with a lab, waste years of resources, maybe just months of resources, months or years of resources, millions of dollars, and go, okay, I'm just going to test it in production. I'm just going to push this to the victim and we'll see what happens. It's not very likely to occur. Then there's going to be some redelivery. So it's this idea that the adversary has to deliver whatever new knowledge or capability they've developed. They're going to either install that malware or modify the access to the system to be able to do their attack. And then they're ultimately going to execute the attack, which could be a variety of different styles of attacks that occur in industrial. Let me flip back and forth real quick. When I say that we have a very defensible environment, it's because I'm saying that we have an extended kill chain. Not only do we have complexity in our environments, not only do we have extra things that are different than just Windows systems, but the adversary has to go through more steps. They have to do more things. And where they can build an environment to mimic an IT network pretty simply, it's very, very complex actually to accurately mimic somebody else's entirety of an ICS. So it just takes more time, which gives defenders an awesome opportunity to discover, detect, and respond to those attackers. Because we do have real attacks again. So I was one of the lead investigators on the Ukraine attack that happened in 2015. And I've outlined it here. We're not going to go through it in depth because I want to get to the crash override stuff. But I included our report that we published up in the right-hand corner. We published it through SANS. I figured the first ever cyber attack on a power grid should likely not be analyzed by vendors, but maybe we should push it out as a sort of a community report. So we did so through SANS. But you'll see there that in the stage one stuff, it was all the typical phishing email, malware drops, getting credentials, finding the environment. You know, that happened in a couple different energy companies in Ukraine in a matter of days. When it came down to that stage two stuff, where they developed malicious firmware for the serial Ethernet devices, which basically bricked some sensitive industrial equipment, they learned how to operate the distribution management system to basically hijack the SCADA environment away from the operators, to open up the circuit breakers at substations to de-energize them, modifying the backup power on the network to make sure the power dropped in the control centers, malware to delete all the Windows systems so the operators didn't have access to SCADA at the end, telephone denial of service on the call center so people couldn't call in. I mean, all the stuff that led into that outage, they were in those environments for around 6 months before the attack. And it doesn't look like they were just waiting around. It looks like they were still learning leading up to it. A much more complicated thing. And the crazy thing is, even after this 6 month operation, they just had 6 hours of outage. So it's bad. And it needs to be taken very, very seriously because it's a very serious red line that was crossed to target civilian infrastructure. But it's still just a 6 hour outage, not the, oh my God, the grid's going down, we're all going to die, build a bunker that we sometimes get exposed to. So let's look at the 2016 one as well. So in 2016, a second attack by the same group targeted Ukraine again, this time targeted a different site. Instead of 60 plus substations across Ukraine, it just targeted one transmission level substation. But that one transmission level substation had three times the power loss of the 60 plus distribution stations across the country, because that's how it works. You have big generation sources, then you have transmission, which is kind of like the backbone of your country, and then you have the smaller distribution sites for your local towns. And restoration of power was within 30 to 60 minutes. So only 30 to 60 minute outage. I think this was probably more testing. In my assessment, this was the adversary sort of testing their capabilities and seeing what they could do more than having a direct effect of, let's just have 1 hour outage. But what was it and why is it concerning? Well, if we look again at that stage one, stage two thing, this attack and everything that we know about it relies on stage two. We actually don't have the incident response data to understand how it got there in the first place. As far as we're aware, you know, Dragos and ESIT were the two firms that did the analysis on this. Dragos published it under the name Crash Override. ESIT published it under the name and Destroyer. And it was basically just malware analysis that we're doing. We're not involved in the investigation. We're not involved in the incident response. And that malware analysis that we were able to do to bring this out to the community and help inform folks really was all about what was being installed and executed. So it's really just the last two, technically the last four, because it was what was developed, but really we just see the installation and the execution of the attack. And that is the malware itself. What was interesting about the malware, and I put our paper on it over on the left there, is it had the traditional, like, here's a backdoor and a launcher and let's delete some files off the system. But what was most interesting about it is it didn't really rely on any exploits or vulnerabilities. There was some vulnerability stuff in there that it could have leveraged, but it had nothing to do with the attack. The attack itself was all about learning and codifying industrial operations. How do I learn how to communicate with electrical equipment to open up circuit breakers, to de-energize areas? How do I do that, and how do I codify it using the protocols that are used in industrial environments, like 101, 104, 6.850, and OPC down at the bottom, are all ICS network protocols and serial TCP protocols that get used. So how can I codify that knowledge to let my malware automate this? Because the interesting thing is in 2015, the attack that occurred when we did have investigation details, it was my assessment to the community that there was around 20 people involved in that operation just by the timing of what they were doing. And it was all manual, right? They were interacting directly with the ICS, interacting directly to disconnect the circuit breakers. Here, it's malware that's automated. So really, you just need one person to put it in place and execute it. This isn't something that's going to spread on top of a ransomware worm or something. That's not how it works. You're going to have to put it in place still. So there's a human operations to limit this from just targeting every site in the world. But it's still something you could replay and do at other sites. In fact, the way that this is built, since it's only dependent on electric grid knowledge and not zero days and things like that, it would actually work all across Europe, most of the Middle East, and most of Asia without any modification. But of course, remember, there's still that whole stage one operation that the adversary has to do to get it in place. It would need some modification. It would probably take a day or two of modifying it to get it to work in the United States, just based off us being a little bit different in our grid usage. But in general, this is a pretty scalable piece of malware. Now, remember, though, it's not highly destructive. It's not put it on a piece of worm, you know, put it on a worm and spread it across the world and take everybody down. It is a 1 hour power outage kind of piece of capability. But it is that sweet spot of the difference between scalability and destruction. Because when you think about it, the more complex a system is, such as the power grid being very complex, the more complex it is, the more resources it takes to attack reliably. And the larger the impact you want to have, maybe having days of outages instead of hours, the more resources you have to spend. But the more impact you want to have or the more duration you want to have of your outage also mean the less scalable it is. So if I develop a capability to spread to the entirety of the power grid, I'm probably going to get 1 hour of outage. But if I develop a capability that's going to destroy equipment and really screw over a facility like Stuxnet, it's only going to work in the TANs. Now, these are sort of soft rules of thumb. We'll see it evolve over the years, I'm sure. But just as a general disparity, the more scalable, the more impactful it is, and the more more scalable, more impactful, the more resources have to go into each. So if I imagine sort of invisible knobs here, invisible like 1 to 10 meter, if I want it 10 on the scalability piece, it's going to take me an exponential level of resources to do that. If I also want it to start rising up that disruption and that impact and duration piece, it's going to be even harder if it's scalable. So long story short, more scalable, less destructive, more destructive, less scalable. And you can try to increase both, but it takes a ton of resources to do so. So this idea that the grid, power lines, oil pipeline, gas, all this stuff is going to come down very quickly and it's so easy by the adversary and all that, it's just simply misleading. We have real threats. We have real concerns. We got to take it seriously, but we should have a little bit of nuance because a lot of the things that we're looking at, even when adversaries get access to industrial control systems and take screenshots and sound scary, it's like the 20% of the effort. Even getting access to the systems isn't the hard part. It's synthesizing all that data and knowing what to do with it to have a reliable, scalable attack. On the IOC 104 module of crash override, just as an example, just laid over an ICS network for you. Basically what happened is it loads onto an HMI, communicates to an RTU, which is a type of physical infrastructure that's controlling circuit breakers, and just opened the circuit breaker. So really the entire attack was just sending legitimate commands to open up the circuit breaker. So there's no vulnerabilities. Again, there's nothing about the protocols that need to change. Encrypting it wouldn't have done anything. The protocols don't have vulnerabilities. It's just that's how the electric grid works. And once the attacker gets in and learns how to do that, then it's not too complicated for them to repeat that. But again, that nuance is it takes a while to get there. It takes a lot of effort. And even at the high end, we've only seen a couple hours of outages. So as we end out the presentation, I take questions for like the 5 or 6 minutes we have left. I want to leave you with something since we've talked about there being a lot of hype and we got to have nuance. And we talked about threats that are real and serious. One of the papers I wrote a couple years ago was called The Sliding Scale of Cybersecurity. And basically positioned the 5 categories of things you can do to increase security. So as you go back out into the world and you try to do security, think about these 5 categories and know that the most return on investment, the biggest value is on the left-hand side of the scale. building something right from the first time, putting logging in place, security in the design of it, good software development, engineering, all that stuff is the sweet spot. When we identify weaknesses, we'll put things like passive defenses on them, like security technologies and tools and firewalls and intrusion detection systems. Active defense is really the people getting involved, the human component of security, instant response, threat hunting, network security monitoring. Intelligence is that collecting and analyzing adversary information to create intelligence that helps us prioritize and address knowledge gaps in our organization. And then offense, I have on there is technically you could do offense to increase security, but seeing how I see a lot of this discussion these days, I want to note all this hack back kind of stuff. One of the reasons I built this scale was to show that regardless of your ethical views of it, it's just not a good return on investment of your resources. And I have to bluntly tell folks sometimes, if you suck at defense, you're going to suck at offense. So we have a lot of opportunities to do real defense. We don't need to get scared. We don't need to have fear driver decisions. We don't need to let things hype us out. And we definitely don't need to be thinking about going back after the adversaries because we have all the tools that we need to be successful. So with that, I'll go ahead and take the questions over on the side. I'll repeat them back to you. And of course, afterwards, always feel free to get in touch with me. I'll note that the easiest way is actually on Twitter. I'm quite a bit more responsive to that than emails. But first question, what do you suggest will help most with research? And that's a little bit vague for me. So research into what areas, if you have time to sort of type back in the chat. But I'll note that in general, when I look into research into ICS security, I often find that people are taking IT security best practices and copy and pasting them into ICS, and it can be dangerous. It's not just necessarily a bad practice. It can actually be dangerous in environments that we're dealing with human life and safety of people in the environment. So what I prefer to see instead is people understand what our risks are and learn from the threat landscape, learn from what the adversaries are doing, into understanding how we're actually going to take unique tradecraft and capabilities and codify best practices. And make sure that our security practices are paired with a real understanding of the risk we're trying to reduce. And with research, it's a lot of times not about the systems themselves. I see a lot of folks want to do research into like finding vulnerabilities on controllers. The vulnerabilities in the controllers might not even be the point. A lot of times they're not. ICS vulnerabilities, you know, a significant majority of them, I think a couple of people have publicly done the research and stated around 90 something percent of them are just trash. They don't actually introduce new risk. They're just stunt hacking kind of stuff. And what I really want to enforce by that is remember it's about the physics, about the engineering, it's about the process, it's about the people. Research into this should be able to figure out how to complement the mission, not restrict it. And how do we make sure that we're addressing the real threats to reduce real risk instead of addressing with resources the hyped out ones, which ultimately aren't helping us out? Yeah, good question. All right, so how do you think the media should behave in these situations? I have seen a lot of journalists get much better at this over years of working with a couple of them. They're getting pretty good. And what I mean by that is we're getting journalists that will get a vendor pitch or they'll get a government official wanting to leak something or they'll hear about one of these big cyber attacks and they reach out to subject matter experts. Instead of just finding some guy or gal who has security in their title, actually find somebody who understands industrial control systems and ask the question, you know, is this a big risk? Why or why not? Ask a couple people because sometimes there might be differences in opinions and figure out what that risk is. And if it's significant, then feel free to report on it. But if it's a phishing email to a couple energy companies, that's really not a big deal. And my significant problem here is I'm not concerned about the grid failing. I think that it's very, very unlikely scenario. Not even unlikely. It's just there's a lot of complexity in that topic, probably for another day. But I'm worried about maybe an adversary taking down Washington, D.C. or San Francisco for 3 hours. You know, politically, that changes things. When the American public is fearful or when that's the psychology of things changes, you know, that's an issue. Or maybe even an accidental attack, when an attacker didn't mean to take something down and does. You know, how do we deal with that where it looks like an act of war and it's not? So I'm concerned about the fear driving policy decisions. I'm concerned about our fear hindering good policy decisions. So sometimes that media hype weighs very heavily with politicians, regulations, and influences things worse than an attack ever could. And then the last question in the last 30 seconds, if the attacker is able to generalize a malicious attack in the future, do you think these attacks can be done by script kiddies? I don't think so. So even when we see crash override, which was that, again, that sweet spot of scalability with some level of outages, it still required all those stage one operations to target a company, do the operations, get it in place, and then actually execute the attack. That requires resources, and it's simply not trivial. And I think that we could find some lone hacker, script kiddie type person that might be able to do some sort of disruption, but not much. And I think we're still a ways off that. But anyways, I've come across my time. Thanks again for joining me. Y'all have a great day and stay true to the message, because our infrastructure is awesome and we can do defense. Take care.